Thank you, Brenna, and thank you, RSA, for having us and hosting this session. We are going to talk about the privacy practices and data protection practices of 1,200 websites. This is the Online Trust Alliance audit. It's our 10th audit, and so we've been at this for a long time, and we'll talk about kind of how we do it and what we found this year. I'm Jeff Wilbur. I'm Technical Director of the Online Trust Alliance at the Internet Society. Joining me today will be Dina Hackett, who's Senior Director of Information Security at Symantec in the Norton LifeLock area. They were our sponsors of this year's report and have a lot of great insight to lend to us today. And then Kenny Olmstead, also with the Internet Society, is our Internet Security and Privacy Analyst. He had the glorious task of assessing 1,200 privacy policies. So when we get to the privacy section, we'll hear from Kenny on what he found. So just to give an overview and some background on what we're doing here, as I mentioned, this is our 10th online trust audit. What we're trying to do here is establish best practices for enterprises in various areas of data protection and privacy and measure the adoption over time. So we're trying to drive adoption and awareness. We generally look beyond the compliance levels in the various industry sectors we look at and look towards stewardship. What's the right thing to do, not what's the minimum thing to do? And really want businesses to enhance their security, data protection, and privacy practices. And as part of this online trust audit, we do an honor roll. And so we're recognizing leadership. And we'll talk about kind of how many of the sites that we address assessed this year may be on a roll. So just some overview of how we do this. We look at multiple sectors. This year it was about 1,200 organizations. Top retailers, banks, consumer services, news and media, you can see the list there. Every year or so we add another sector. This year the healthcare sector was new. And the healthcare sector of the 100 that we assessed was made up of hospital chains, pharmacies, medical labs, and medical insurance companies, so kind of a mix of those. The way our scoring works is we look at three main categories. So that's the Venn diagram you see on the right, consumer protection, security, and privacy. Each one of those has 100 points available, and so we have a composite analysis where we kind of weight things against each other, so 300 would be a perfect score. But we do have bonus points available for new and emerging practices, penalties for vulnerabilities, breaches, and settlements. And so to make our honor roll, think of it as a school honor roll, the AB honor roll, you have to score 80% or higher with no failures in any of those three main categories. And the failure bar in each category is 60 points. So if you had great consumer protection and security score but had a 50 in privacy, you would fail our audit. That's kind of how our methodology works. Every year we kind of raise the bar and look at new criteria, what are the latest and greatest best practices, regulatory environments and such to come up with our methodology. We'll talk a bit about that at the end. So what did we see this year? We saw a record achievement in the honor roll part of things. So you can see the last 4 years, the honor roll achievement was in kind of the mid-40s to low 50s. If you rewind a few years prior to that, it was in the high 30s and low 40s. We saw a big jump this year, and that was primarily due to improvements in email authentication. That has been an area where a lot of sectors had a major number of failures in prior years, and this year there was a significant amount of adoption, especially in DKIM, which we'll talk about, one of the components of email authentication. And that led to a record honor roll achievement. As part of identifying who the leaders are, we name a top 50 overall out of these 1,200 organizations. And here are the top 50. They're clustered by sector, so we have banks on the top left, and then news and ISP hosting sites kind of to the right of that, the federal government to the right of that, on the lower row there we have consumer sites, that's the predominant top scorers, then retailers, then healthcare, and so 23andMe and Costco were the two top 50s in the healthcare sector, and then the Internet Society organizational members, and the Online Trust Alliance itself is the highest score there. So the green outline is the top score in each of those sectors. So you kind of get a sense of who the top scorers are and who were the top scorers within those top scores. Google News actually was the overall top score this year. So looking at it by sector, again, this is 4 years worth of data. We could go back further, but then it gets very, very tight on the charts. We do break out the Internet Retailer 100 and 500 from each other, just kind of show how the bigger companies are doing versus the broader set. But then we have all the rest of the sectors lined up there. So a couple notes on this. We saw in our last audit that both the banks and the federal government, you can see most sectors are moving nicely kind of up and to the right as you would want to see. But banks had a significant drop-off in our last audit, and the federal government had a modest drop-off. Those were primarily due for banks. It was email authentication and privacy practices where they didn't continue to kind of up their game. Federal government had a dip there as well, but you can see they more than recovered this year, and banks surged up into the 70% range, whereas the federal government actually grew to 91% of the 100 sites making the honor roll, so they actually overtook the consumer sector, which has always been the leading sector historically. The other sector of note is the news sector, news and media sector. They are on a great up and to the right path. The first year we assessed them, they were 4%, then they went 8, 23, and so on now in the 70s. And that's just a great continued growth, and so kudos to them. Dina, I know you guys have been a part of this audit for many years, and I was just wondering, what do you see that's notable here in terms of the trends?
So the first thing I'll say is within the consumer sector, consumers vote with their dollars and they expect a level of trust from companies. So it's not very surprising to see that they're towards the top of the honor roll, like behind the federal government. Building and maintaining trust with the consumer sector is vital for companies to succeed. To be a successful consumer brand, you have to establish trust through consistency and delivering value to the customer and winning over their hearts and minds. And I know as a consumer myself, I do have brand trust and brand loyalty influencing my buying decisions. And then the other noteworthy trend on here is regarding the bank trend. So I started my cybersecurity professional career in the financial services industry, which is a critical component of everyone's life. We must trust banks and financial institutions to protect our most valuable asset, our money. Recently, some financial institutions haven't had the best reputation, and they're focused on rebuilding confidence across their customer base. As a result, many financial institutions have set the tone at the top, but security's a priority, which likely led to the significant increase in the bank honor roll recipients for 2018.
Yeah, that's great input, and we definitely saw a great resurgence on the bank side, so obviously we've been putting some work into that. So going on, another way we kind of view this is looking at the range of scores for each sector. So you can see it ranges from the low of about 40%, which is a very poor score, up to almost 120%. So there's some definite overachievers there, scoring over 100. And then the green line across the middle is the median score. So in prior years, there was most of the sectors hovered right around that 80% line. So they were, you know, a few points either above or below making our honor roll. You can see that this year the median score is easily up in the high 80s or low 90s, depending on the sector. And overall, it's in the kind of 80 or 90 range. And so we definitely saw a big move up in scoring this year, despite the fact that we continue to raise the bar in our criteria every year. So we talked about the good side. Let's flip it upside down and look at who failed and why. So this is kind of looking at the other side. Where is there room for improvement? And so Again, this is broken into those three main areas of consumer protection, which is largely email authentication, site security, and privacy. So you can see in consumer protection that the reason for failure varies widely, from just a few percent of retailers up to mid-30s for the healthcare sector, where the overall is 13%. Site security tends to be a pretty good area for just about every sector, although it does vary in terms of failure. Surprisingly, banks have a 6% failure rate there. You would kind of expect them to be better, I suppose. And then overall, privacy was the highest reason for failure at 15%, and the retailers were the ones that had the most failures in that area. There are some organizations that fail in more than one area. Only 3% failed in more than one area. And so we look at this very closely on what we should focus on and guidance we can give to different sectors on where they have room for improvement. Dina, is there anything surprising in the results here that you see?
I wouldn't say that there's anything surprising. I think since healthcare was a new sector added to the audit for 2018, I'm not really surprised to see the fact that they're lagging behind as it relates to this information security assessment. And like, and, you know, many patients still provide their sensitive data and medical history, like using forms. And only recently have I been to a healthcare provider where I've had to complete my information on tablets. So I think there's some work to do as it relates to the healthcare sector, which might explain why they've had a lot of failures if you look at this chart.
Yeah, and that definitely was a new area for us this year. And you can see that the thing that primarily drove their failure rate was actually email authentication. That's something that's fairly straightforward to address, I think. So we'll be tracking that now going forward. So another way we look at this is what percent made the honor roll? We already looked at that. What percent failed? When you add those together, is there any middle ground? And it turns out there's very little middle ground depending on the sector. So you look across this, the gold kind of strike there is those that either didn't make the honor roll or fail. And you can see in some sectors like banks and healthcare, there was no middle ground. You either made the honor roll or you failed. And this is a trend now we've seen for several years. So usually what happens is there's a weakness in one area that causes a failure. You don't tend to see organizations that have kind of a C, you know, kind of middle grade score. They have maybe an F in one area and they might be doing well in the others. So we track this as well. So now we're going to move into each of the three categories. The first one is consumer and domain protection. We'll talk about the criteria for each area, what we saw, and so forth. But first, to kind of set the stage, since this one is so focused on email authentication, thought it would be useful, depending on the background of the attendees here, to explain some of the acronyms and how they fit together. So in email authentication, there are two primary technologies that use. To get used. One is called Sender Policy Framework, or SPF. One is called Domain Keys Identified Mail, which is DKIM. And they are different approaches to being able to verify that a message actually came from the purported sender. SPF authenticates the path between the sender and the recipient. DKIM actually authenticates the content itself, that it hasn't been modified in transit. So they each do things differently, but they complement each other in terms of edge cases and best practices to do both on your email, whether it's at the top level of the organization, like paypal.com, or any subdomains where email is sent. DMARC, which came out about 5 years ago, is a way to kind of synthesize the email authentication of SPF and DKIM and make better use of it. So one of the things that can happen on the lower right there is you can generate reports, and you can say, hey, I want to see reports of how many of my messages are passing or failing authentication, and you can look at that in either an aggregated sense or a message-by-message sense. It also gives you that visibility, so the best practice here is to implement DMARC where you're getting the reports, you can make sure you have your authentication act together, so to speak, and then move to the, on the lower left there, the policy element of DMARC lets you tell recipients how to treat your messages if they fail authentication. So your choices are to tell them nothing about it, to quarantine the messages, like put it in a junk folder or spam folder kind of thing, or reject the message outright. And the best practice here is once you know you are authenticating your email properly is to tell the recipients to reject unauthenticated messages. That way they never make it to the inbox of the users and therefore help protect against phishing. So that's kind of a foundation of how these things are used and how they go together. So if we look at the actual criteria in this category, and you're going to see a very similar kind of approach in each of the three categories. So the gray box is our baseline points, the green is bonus, the red is penalty. And anything in italics was something that changed from the last audit to this audit. So we call this the 2018 audit, and just to be clear, it's because we took a snapshot of data at the end of 2018. Even though the report came out in April of this year, we call it the 2018 audit. So in baseline points, what we're looking for is that you're implementing SPF and DKIM at the top level in any subdomains. We increased the weight on that this year at the top level. We're looking for DMARC, that you have a record and you have a policy. And if you have the reject policy, that's the ultimate goal. So we increase the weight on that. We increased the overall weight on DMARC this year. You'll see that SPF and DKIM are fairly widely adopted, but DMARC is kind of lagging that, so we want to put more emphasis on adoption of DMARC. And then we do look for the validity of these records. In prior years, if you had a record, we said, okay, it's there. Now we're looking at kind of inside the record saying, is it valid? Bonus points are using opportunistic TLS for email that encrypts messages between mail servers. We increase the weight on that, whether you use DNSSEC, whether you use IPv6, and then penalties if you don't administratively lock your domain. So we're kind of blending email and domain management sort of characteristics here in this category. So that gives you a foundation for what we're looking for in terms of our criteria. So let's look at what we found. The three sets of bar charts here are SPF at the top level, DKIM at the top level, and then SPF and DKIM both at any level. So you can see SPF overall is about 90% adoption at the top level. It's pretty tight between the different sectors. DKIM is a little lower, 83% overall. Healthcare was the lagging sector there. The consumer sites are very high. You can see they're up in the 90s, high 90s on everything. And then SPF and DKIM across any domain is at or approaching 100% in nearly every sector. So it's strong adoption, but there still are those few percent, and in the case of healthcare with DKIM, some room to improve there. Looking at this over time, we can see, and there's a lot of numbers on this chart, but just point out a few things. We did see some good movement between the last audit and this audit, especially in the federal government. That had been an area that was lagging. You can see they were the lowest sector in 2017 for supporting both SPF and DKIM, and they more than doubled that. A lot of that was due to a directive that came out in late 2017 saying that all the federal sites should adopt SPF and DKIM and DMARC as well. So we're seeing solid growth in this area pretty much across the board. Looking at DMARC, we look at kind of two aspects of this. Do you have a DMARC record? And then are you asserting a policy of some kind? And a term that gets used here is enforcement. If you have a policy that says quarantine or reject, that means you're enforcing with DMARC. And so that's kind of how we're looking at it here. We saw very strong use and growth in DMARC records. So the last audit we did, the use of records was at 34%. It grew to 50% overall this year, led by the federal government in the high 90s there, again, due to that directive. And then in terms of enforcement, last time we saw 15% of the organizations were doing enforcement. Now it's 24, again led by the federal government up in the 80s. And so we saw strong growth there across the board, but especially in the government due to that directive, which was great. So looking at this kind of consumer protection category, Dina, are there any best practices that organizations aren't following that kind of surprise you in this area?
I think, and you're covering it on this slide, but I think it's surprising to me that more companies haven't yet implemented DMARC enforcement, whether they're rejecting or quarantining their message to make sure that their domain is protected against spoofing of company emails. I do recognize that it is somewhat difficult to implement rejection on your domains, especially when you're having third parties sending emails on your behalf, but it's definitely not impossible, and there are industry tools that can help you kind of move from monitoring your records to fully rejecting them. And I think more, I mean, as you stated earlier, as far as SPF and DKIM adoption, I think more companies are recognizing that email is still an easy attack vector for easy vector for attackers, so they are investing more time and money on email security controls. But I think what's surprising is just the low percentage of DMARC enforcement.
Yeah, I would agree with you. And you know, what I've heard in talking to some companies is they're kind of nervous about that enforcement level, because if they do it wrong, their email won't get through. But as you mentioned, there's lots of industry tools and companies out there to kind of help through that process. And DMARC is well set up for that, because you can do the reporting first to get feedback on whether you're doing your authentication correctly, and then you can start to ratchet it up to do the enforcement so that you don't make mistakes that are going to kind of hurt you as you go through that process. So just a final note on DMARC here. Again, this is looking at it over time. You can see in the middle here, we saw big jumps in both banks and the federal government, which kind of explained on adoption of records. And then we saw big jumps in enforcement in both the federal government and the consumer sector. Those are the top two sectors in terms of enforcement levels. So we're glad to see these kind of moves, and we'll be continuing to track that as well. Now we're going to move on to the next section, site security. Similar setup here in terms of the criteria. So the baseline points are primarily driven by your SSL TLS implementation. So there are a couple tools out there, which I'll point out in a few slides here, that can be used to see how you're doing in that. This year, we also looked at a blend of your application and network security settings, your IP reputation, and your patching cadence, like did you have outdated software on the site. We did increase the weight in that area. In prior years, we had, and for many years now, actually, we've had as bonus points that you fully encrypt the web sessions. It's called Always On SSL or HTTPS Everywhere that goes by various names. There's a technology you can use called HSTF that ensures it. So there's a lot of ways to name it, but we moved that to baseline points this year, and because it's so important, and we did see a kind of a big trend happening there. Bonuses are use of extended validation certificates, whether you have a web application firewall, whether you have a way to for outsiders to report vulnerabilities, and then something called certificate authority authorization. This is where you post in your DNS which certificate authorities are allowed to issue certificates on your behalf, and it can help prevent certificates being issued for you fraudulently. So, and that is a mandatory for certificate authorities to check on this is whenever they issue certificates, and so we added that as bonus this year. Penalties if you have various vulnerabilities or malware found on your site. So that kind of gives you a setup of what we look for. So looking at the scores themselves, you can see that, and we saw this in the failure rate, but you can see that scores are generally pretty high in this area. They're not 100, but they're kind of up in that 90 range overall. So the baseline scores range from 86 to 94, where the federal government was the leader in this area. In terms of the always-on SSL assessment, that's where we saw the biggest jump from our last audit. It was 52% overall last time. It was 93% this time. So it's huge. Surge in use of encrypting the web session from the moment it starts. You can see it extended validation certificates, and these are the ones where you get some kind of indicator of who owns the certificate, and depending on the browser, the bar may turn green, or there might be kind of a green indicator somewhere. It's been, in the early days, it was fairly prominent. It's been kind of deprecated a bit over time in terms of the visual distinction. As you can see, that varies quite a bit. Banks use it pretty heavily, over 70%. You can see the federal government and news sites use it the least, and averages out to about 25% of sites overall. And then this new criteria that's bonus points, the certificate authority authorization, first look at that this year, and we saw 6% overall, led by consumer sites at 20. And so this is something that we encourage organizations to do, because it does kind of restrict who can issue certificates on your behalf, and therefore prevent fraudulent certificates from being issued. These are some of the tools that we use. Top left is Qualys. Top middle is ImmunoWeb, used to be called Hi-Tech Bridge. They both have a very similar assessment of your SSL TLS configuration. And they give you a letter grade. We map that to a score. And they not only tell you what the letter grade is, they often map it to various compliance things and tell you where you're lacking. So whether it's use of certain protocols, certain cipher suites with certain protocols, and so forth, is where we get a lot of our scoring and information. And this can change. These are updated continuously, all these tools. And so we took a snapshot in early January for this audit, but it could be that you're getting an A today and a new vulnerability gets discovered and you're getting a C tomorrow. And so it's useful to use these tools on a regular basis to see what's going on and what you need to do to keep pace. The two letter grades on the right that you see are focused on web security headers. So ImmunoWeb, again, has one like that, and then Mozilla Observatory is another one. So we use the blend of those scores to feed into our methodology. On the lower left is security, which looks at various other website things, like they look for malware, web app firewalls, and so forth. And then lower middle there is internet.nl. They look at a variety of things as well, including DNSSEC and IPv6 and, you know, all sorts of other things. There's a lot of overlap between these tools, but they're all free, and what we're trying to do is find tools that anyone can get access to so they can assess themselves and look for areas for improvement and therefore improve the overall security of their site. So one other area that we looked at that's bonus points is vulnerability reporting. This is also called responsible disclosure, coordinated disclosure, that kind of thing. We saw nearly a doubling since our last audit in use of this. What we were looking for was either on the site itself for an organization or via a third-party bug bounty program, that a site has a way for a researcher or anyone who discovers a vulnerability to report that in a responsible way to the owner of the site. We saw that consumer sector was the leader here with 43%. You can kind of see the others. And so we're just looking for this. This is becoming more and more important for as a means for people to report vulnerabilities and get them addressed in a responsible manner versus kind of going broad and public with it and running the risk of having sites attacked while these vulnerabilities exist. This is kind of the end of the site security section. So, Dina, did you have any comments, you know, with maybe easy things that you've seen that organizations aren't doing today that they should be?
Yeah, I think having a mechanism for security researchers or customers to report technical vulnerabilities is pretty critical And as you stated, like, it minimizes the risk of a public disclosure of a vulnerability. So I've seen, you know, some companies have a publicly available security email address where you can report vulnerabilities. The only, I guess the drawback to that method is at times if you don't specify what information you need, you might not get all the pertinent information to triage the vulnerability and then start the remediation of the vulnerability. So it might prolong the remediation timeline. So I definitely think the form-based submissions, similar to what you're displaying on the screen for the Online Trust Alliance, helps make sure that the data is actually collected and then minimizes like the back and forth between the reporter and the company. And I've seen that companies don't have either. So if you're trying to responsibly disclose a vulnerability and you don't actually have a mechanism, most people will contact like customer support, and those individuals might not have the knowledge or expertise to route the vulnerability to the appropriate team. Or worse, like the researcher might get so frustrated that they just decide to report it, you know, publicly through a blog or through social media. So I definitely see value in at least having, at a minimum, a publicly reported security or, you know, a publicly available security email address and or, you know, a form-based submission process.
Yeah, those are great points, because you want to have that path between reporting and the responsible people as short as possible so you can address it very quickly. We actually, even on the OTA side, it's primarily just an informational one. We, over the last few years, have had a couple of reports of the vulnerabilities that we have. We addressed them right away, and it was a very smooth process. So I think this is something that any organization can do. They just have to kind of set their mind to it, that it's in a important. So we're going to move on to the privacy area now. Again, one of our three major categories. The setup here in terms of baseline points, it's broken into two major pieces. One is what you say in your privacy statement, or in the U.S. it's primarily called a privacy policy, usually. And so we're looking for language about data sharing and data retention and third-party sharing, what you're going to do with the do not track standard, that your notices are layered, meaning it's kind of it's organized in a way where you can kind of go at it piece by piece instead of a big flat intimidating legal document, that you have a link on your homepage to your privacy statement, you make some statement about whether you're collecting data on minors or the purpose of the site regarding minors, that you have a date stamp so people know how current the privacy statement is. And then what used to be bonus points, but we rolled into baseline this year, is do you have some sort of access to a prior version of the privacy statement, either a comparison of what changed or literally just a link back to the prior version. The issue here is transparency, what changed between the prior version and this version if people care to look. That's 55 of the 100 points. And then 45 is based on your third-party trackers. And I'll talk about how we access that data and how we look at it. Bonus points is use of icons, again, to navigate more easily, whether you disclose that you track people across different devices, whether you honor the do not track signal, whether you have a multilingual policies available, whether you use a tag management or privacy solution, that ties to the trackers. If you have a lot of trackers on your site, you want to have some way to manage those. This year, even though GDPR doesn't really apply in the U.S. Necessarily, and most of the organizations we assess are U.S.-based, not all of them, but most, we went ahead and took an early snapshot of GDPR-compliant language, and we'll talk about what we looked at there and what we found. Penalties, if you have a private who is record. The issue here is transparency again. Who owns the site? So we're not looking for individual contact information there. We're looking for organizationally who owns the site. If you had data breaches, and this year we scaled the penalty according to the size of the breach. Prior to now, it had been kind of a flat penalty. And then when you had any FTC or state or global settlements against you in terms of consumer data security or privacy. So roll all this up, and these are all the components that make up the privacy scores. So looking at this overall, again, the baseline score is 100 points. We saw the average overall was 70, fairly tight range here from the kind of 67 range to 76. So the consumer side's led overall, but that's a fairly tight range. If you break that down into the two pieces, out of 55, the overall average for the privacy statement score was 27. That's the most concerning area for us, because if you have 55 points available and the overall average is 27, that means people are scoring less than half of the available points, and that's not good. So we're going to really focus on this area going forward. And the range wasn't that broad here either. We see it ranging from 25 to 33, so there really aren't any outstanding scorers here in terms of sectors. The tracking score, again, was 45, and what we do here is we start you at 45, and then we deduct points for every tracker that you have that is known to share data with others. So if it's an analytics-type tracker, a benign kind of thing, it doesn't count against you. But if it's one that's maybe advertising-oriented or it shares data broadly with others, it starts to deduct from your score of starting point of 45. Again, we saw a fairly tight range here from 39 to 45, averaging 42. So that's reasonably good overall. And then in terms of managing those trackers, you can see that the use of tag management systems varies quite a bit by sector, averaging 71%. So we did see in the overall scoring a dip of 3 points from the last audit that we did. It was primarily in the area of the privacy statements themselves. Dina, in terms of privacy, what trends do you think organizations should be paying closer attention to?
So privacy has been getting a lot of attention lately, especially with regulations like GDPR and other similar privacy regulations that different states are evaluating. So, and obviously a lot of companies have published privacy policies, but they are overly complex and really long, and it makes it really difficult for the average consumer to understand. So I think what organizations should pay closer attention to is trying to simplify their privacy policies so that they're more easily understood and allowing for the easier navigation through their lengthy privacy policies, because I do understand and recognize that privacy policies have to cover various aspects, so they wind up being pretty lengthy. But I do like that the Online Trust Alliance helps, you know, or like provides some recommendations to allow for easier navigation, like the use of icons as an example.
Yeah, great. It really all does roll together, right? How easy is the language? How easy is it to navigate? We try to have different criteria and factors that sort of blend all that together. Ultimately, though, the language also has to include the fact that you aren't sharing data with third parties, except in certain circumstances and so forth. So it is a challenging task for companies. We recognize that. But we're trying to, again, go, as I said at the very beginning, go beyond compliance to more stewardship. What is the right thing to do in this area? And privacy certainly is an area of focus that a lot of people are paying attention to this year. So looking at the tracker side, we use data from a company called Disconnect to look for trackers. This graphic is a snapshot out of their Chrome plugin at the CNN site. And every little circle with a red flash through it that you see there is a tracker that they automatically block because it's known to share data with others. So you can see there are quite a few on CNN site. We're not picking on them. The news and media segment in general is one that uses a lot of trackers because their business model is based on advertising. And so you tend to see their average is more than double the average of the rest of the sectors. Some sectors are very low, so it does vary quite a bit. A lot of this technology is now being incorporated into browsers to automatically block access to certain trackers, and it can be fine-tuned by users. So this is kind of how we look at the trackers and discover that data. Now we're going to go on to the next three or four slides. We're going to look at the privacy statements themselves. I'm going to ask Kenny Olmstead, who assessed all these, to kind of weigh in these different areas. So the first one is about transparency. Are you telling us what's going on so that we can make sense of this? So Kenny, you want to jump in and kind of talk about these results?
Sure thing. Thanks, Jeff. So this first section is all about the transparency, and as we touched on earlier, the main goal of this whole looking at privacy statements is so consumers can understand what companies are doing with their data. So the first variable we looked at is there a date stamp at top? And we feel that that is very important, especially given, and Dina mentioned this earlier, that laws around the world are constantly changing. And if there's no date stamp at top, there's no way for the user to know that this privacy policy is up to date, given everything that's happening. Archives are very similar. The archive score this year is very low. The reason that we think archives are important is that it shouldn't be up to the user to look backwards and see what changed when a privacy policy is updated, especially given that under GDPR and CCPA, which is the new California law, when a privacy policy is updated, companies have to tell the user. And so if there's no way for the user to know what the previous policy was, we feel that that's not, the companies aren't being transparent. Jeff mentioned earlier, do not track. As you can see, most, or about half the companies say they honor, or sorry, say they, something about do not track. Most of them don't honor it. The reason for that is do not track, as the slide says, is essentially a dead standard. We most likely will not be measuring this next year, given that the new California law doesn't require this anymore, so companies will no longer have to say anything about do not track. Jeff, you're going to do the next slide.
Yeah, one other quick point. We're going to be doing some further analysis on the date stamps. It sounds kind of trivial, but it was very interesting, our findings. About a third of the sites had none, and then progressively how old some of the privacy policies. They had a date stamp maybe back in 2011, and of course we saw a big surge in early 2018 as people revamped their privacy statements for GDPR. And so it's kind of all over the map, and some sectors are doing really well, and some sectors are really lagging, and so we'll be releasing some more analysis on that. So moving on, these criteria are about readability. So Kenny, what did we find?
Sure. So as Jeff mentioned earlier, a layered notice, there are many ways to fulfill this particular variable. Essentially, the idea is making the privacy policy easier to read, and it's everything from simply a table of contents would get you a point for layered notice. Other sites do summaries of the longer policy. Some of them do drop-down menus. There are lots of ways to make a privacy policy much easier for a user to read rather than just a big block of text. And as you can see, the ISPs were the worst at this, and the best was the news section. About 70% of the sites had a layered notice. And we think this is important simply because, as if any of you actually read a privacy statement, they are very hard to read generally, and this is a really good way to help users navigate it. Icons are another way to do that. Part of this is making a privacy policy readable at most grade levels. As you can see, most of the sites don't use icons. Part of the reason that we think this is that there really isn't a sort of common lexicon for icons. For the sites that do it, sometimes they'll use a megaphone for sharing, sometimes they'll use a lock for security, but there's really no sort of common language. But we at OTA think it's important to include icons because it makes it easier for everyone to read the privacy policy. And then finally, having multilingual policies, we think is also very important. There's one caveat here. The one thing we don't know for sure with multilingual is that it is possible that sites are serving up different languages depending on where the user is coming into it. So next year we are toying around with the idea of using VPNs to look at these sites. If there are sites that have multilingual policies that we just didn't see because there was no link to it. And I think one good thing that we did see a big jump in layered statements. That's great. We hope that continues into the next year.
Yeah, so moving on, this is about data handling, and this is really the core of our scoring for the privacy statement, is the language about whether and how you're sharing data and what you're doing with data.
Yes, thank you. And so in previous years, this was one variable, which is the data not shared on the left, and that was specifically about third policies. And as you can see, that's sort of all over the place. Banks are the worst about not sharing with third, or at least saying that they don't share with third parties. The healthcare sector is the highest. This year, we added a new variable because we noticed that there was, on occasion, there were sites that would say, we don't share data with third parties, but we do share it with, and the word, sometimes it was affiliates, sometimes it was corporate partners. There were lots of different ways that companies conveyed this, and our feeling was it's unfair to the consumer to have them know what the corporate structure is. So if you're saying we don't share data with third parties, but we do share it within our corporate family, if it's a gigantic company, it's not fair to the user to go back and look to see that, you know, company A is actually affiliated with company B. So we actually felt that, I think next year we're going to include this variable and probably get a little more into the details of the language because it's all over the place and how companies convey this. And then data retention is a variable we've also looked at for a long time. And this essentially is there a statement saying somewhere that the company will only hold your data for a specific period of time. This, as you can see, is very low across the board. The reason for this is that most of these statements do have a statement that says we retain data, but it's usually we retain data as long as we need it for business purposes. And we feel that that's not enough. It's also not GDPR compliant, but we feel that you should have a sort of time frame on how long data is retained, and it should say it in the statement. And then finally, vendor compliance. This is related to data sharing in that we were looking for some statement or section saying that if, say, a credit card processor is another company, that the company A holds their vendors to the same standards that they hold themselves to. We feel this is very important because obviously relationships between companies and data sharing are very complicated, and if a company is not holding its partners to the same standards, then we feel it's dangerous for users. And Jeff, one more slide in there. And then as Jeff mentioned earlier, we added these this year for the first time. And again, most of the companies that we study, at least currently, are not under GDPR. They're mostly US companies. But we felt this was important to add because, as most of you I'm sure know, the GDPR went into effect and is setting the standard really around the world for in a lot of ways, and especially if you're a large company, you almost certainly have customers in Europe, and so you need to be GDPR compliant. We added six variables this year. Easy to read is essentially under GDPR. Privacy statements should be able to be read at the sixth grade level is generally in the US terms, 32%. We're easy to read. Next year, we are going to add a tool to this to make, Hemingway is a tool, an online tool that grades how hard text is to read. We're going to add that into methodology going forward. The reason for data collection is also something under GDPR, and essentially that says that somewhere in the privacy statement, the company has to tell users why it's collecting data and how it's being used. So, for example, we collect your birth date because we need it for X purpose. Most companies have something like this. That's mostly because in the data sharing section, we almost always have a we collect data for X reason, so that's good. Specifying the types of third parties that receive data. So this is another GDPR requirement. Essentially, companies have to say that they share data with marketers or credit card companies or banks. They don't actually have to specify which companies, but they do have to specify the categories of companies that data is shared with. As you can see, this is very low. Again, the US is not under GDPR, so companies here don't have to do that. But it is important to note that the California law that goes into effect on January 1st of 2020 does include a section that's very similar to this. So U.S. companies will have to have some type of statement saying who they share data with, at least in categories. The ability to contact the data protection officer, you can see most companies do have this, and that's great. To get credit for this, we basically had, there has to be an email or a phone number or an address somewhere in the privacy statement that if you need to reach out to the company for any reason, you can. We obviously would like to see that be higher, and that is a requirement of both GDPR and the new California law, so that is something companies really need to be doing. Handling sensitive data is sort of a weird one. Under GDPR, there is a specific list of data, it's about 20 things, types of data that you have to tell users if you're getting it from third parties. It's stuff like political affiliation, sexual orientation, things like that. This is very low, but that again is not a surprise because US companies under GDPR and under GDPR, if you don't collect that that type of data, you don't have to say anything. So the only situation in which you have to fulfill this is if you, A, are collecting this kind of data, and B, are sharing it. And then finally, user data requests. This is a big part of GDPR and is in the California law. Users have to be able to reach out to companies and delete their data down or download it, or at least know what kind of data the companies have about them. About 50% of the companies in our sample did this, led by retailers and healthcare. This is a GDPR requirement, but it's also a California law requirement. So a lot of the GDPR variables we looked at last year also apply to the new California law that goes into effect in January of next year. Also, many of these principles are in the Washington law, the New York state law. So these are really things that while they started in GDPR, they're being sort of borrowed by many other states and presumably the federal government in the U.S.
Thank you, Kenny. And we will be adapting our methodology to reflect the California Consumer Privacy Act, as Kenny was talking about, and other U.S. regulation, and we intend to be expanding this audit to more parts of the world as well, so we'll have to look at the regulatory environments there for our methodology as well. I'm going to jump to kind of a quick summary here. Wanted to point you to the resources that we have. The primary link for the honor roll itself and kind of all the pieces that go with it. There's an infographic, there's a summary video, and so forth, are at this link, otalliance.org/2018honor roll. One of the things we did, you know, we went through a lot of criteria, right, in all those different sections. We summarized them all on one page in sort of a checklist fashion, as you see the screenshot here. And the purpose of that is that you could, on one page, kind of go through and say, okay, how am I doing in all these areas? As a way to self-assess. If you do have any questions or comments about the audits, about the methodology, anything else, you can just send it to OTA at ISOC, as we call it, .org, that's Internet Society. So those are kind of your resource link. And then what should you do next? How do you apply this? So as I mentioned, use that checklist to see how you're doing. In the audit itself, we specify as we go through various tools that you can use to assess yourself on the email authentication in the site security area. And then privacy is mostly looking at your own privacy statements, although the disconnect tool can help you with the trackers. We are going to do deeper dives in some of these areas as either reports or blog posts or webinars, so stay tuned for that. We're always looking for feedback on the next year's audit. So going forward, we're intending to release this in the January timeframe, kind of around Data Privacy Day every year. So we've already been looking at changes to the methodology for our 2019 audit, and we're open for feedback on that. We're kind of working that within our own committees, but then we'll do a public comment period during the summer and then kind of announce our methodology in the September timeframe. So I'm going to jump on to questions. I know we've had a couple fed in. Michelle's asking about if we have any data on manufacturing. We primarily focus on consumer-facing sectors for this audit, and so we haven't typically focused on manufacturing itself since it's more business-to-business type activity, but we are definitely open to looking at new sectors. And suggestions there. We, you know, healthcare had been a suggestion for a couple of years now, and we finally added it this year. And then we, someone else asked about the T in TMS, that's tag management systems, and those are associated with the trackers, that you can manage the trackers. One of the things that we heard from people over the years is, you know, we would say, hey, we saw, you know, 12 kind of bad trackers on your site. And they say, oh, no, we don't have those. And then you go look and you find they are there, but they got installed years ago and they aren't being used anymore, but they're still there. That's where a tag management system can be very useful to kind of see and manage all that. So we have another question about the assessment of email and text language and consent opt management. So I am assuming, well, I shouldn't assume, We do a separate report every year on email marketing and unsubscribe. And if that's kind of what you're getting at, we actually have a completely separate audit on that. We've done five in the past. What we do is sign up for promotional emails from the top 200 retailers, and we track that whole process, and we unsubscribe and see what happens during that process and whether they ultimately whether they honor that unsubscribe. And we look at the opt-in part on the front end. You know, are they requiring a double opt-in like you would see in Europe, or is it not like you would see in the U.S.? And so we do track a lot of that detail in that separate audit, which you can find if you go to otalliance.org as well. You'll see a, I think it's a publication page where you'll have the archive of the last audits that we've done. So does anyone else have any other questions? I don't see any right now. I know we're close to the hour. I wanted to give Dina, give you a chance to maybe make some closing remarks on, I know you guys have followed this audit very closely over the years and used it to improve your own security and privacy practices. So maybe you can give us a closing remark.
Yeah, sure. So the Online Trust Alliance annual assessment has been extremely valuable for us because it's allowed us to constantly like reassess our security posture, and it's actually influenced some of our prioritization as far as, you know, actually doing the DMARC enforcement was largely because it was being assessed by the Online Trust Alliance or using opportunistic TLS or extended SSL certificates. And the fact that they published their methodology has been really helpful. And the, as Jeff was stating earlier, they do leverage free tools that are available to all of us as security practitioners that we can use prior to the audit. And they have a lot of great materials on their website. So I'd encourage you to like refer to the materials and use it to serve as a baseline for evaluating your security program. And I learned something in this webinar about the checklist. I wasn't aware of that, but I think it's great to have like a single pane of glass on just best practices as it relates to a holistic information security program. And then to Kenny's point, it sounds like they're doing a lot of, I guess, reevaluation of what to include or not include in the upcoming audit. And so it's always great to see that they're constantly evolving their assessment as the industry evolves.
Thanks, Dina, and thank you for your participation today. Kenny, thanks for your insight and observations. And again, I want to thank everyone who attended and for RSA for hosting this. Thank you.
Great. Yes, thank you all to our speakers for a great presentation today, and thanks to all of you, our listeners, for joining us for this RSA Conference webcast. Have a great day.